How to make effective notes. Note making is like an Achilles heel among majority of students in the war against competitive examinations. Today I will give you a total of 6 points as to how can you make more effective notes for yourself. In these 6 points, first 5 points will be do's and don'ts, and the 6th point will be a live demo which will tell you how do I make notes and how you can use a very popular Cornell method to make notes for yourself. Let's start. The first point is, don't be afraid of making notes. I see a lot of students who are very afraid and scared of note making. They feel that they'll be spending majority of their time in note making and not studying. The problem lies in their approach towards note making. Note making has to be a very utilitarian task, wherein you go in for using minimum time for maximum efficiency. But a lot of students end up spending a lot of time in note making and they forget about using those notes for maximizing their effectiveness. I will teach you, don't worry, how to make notes in the minimum time span for maximum efficiency. The second point is, you have to start learning to make notes online. Please stop using pen and paper to make regular notes if you're preparing for these tough and competitive examinations like RBI, SEBI, banks, or UPSC. Start making notes online. The third point is, get a laptop. I see a lot of students who study and who make notes on their mobile phone. Please get rid of your mobile phone if you have to in order to get a laptop. Instagram is not as important as your career or your future. The next is, what apps to use in order to make notes. There are 2 very popular apps, Evernote and OneNote. You can download both of them and make notes on both of them for the first 3-4 days in order to have a good comparison yourself, and whatever fits your approach, whatever you like better, you can use that. The next major point is updation. The biggest advantage of making notes online is that you can update them whenever you want to. But in the laziness of updating them later, do not forget this activity. It's very important that you keep updating your notes with all the current affairs and whatever changes are made instantly, so that you don't have to look for these updations in different notes or in different PDFs or in different content. So keep updating these notes online immediately. Now, before starting with a live demo, let me tell you that before starting with your note making exercise, it's very important that you create a very well-defined and rough structure as to how are you going to go forward with the activity of note making. In the process of live demo that I'm going to give you now, I will also tell you how to create a good rough structure for your note making exercise. Let's start. So let us start with our note making demo. As I had told you that I will be creating a rough structure, or I'll be telling you how to create a good structure before you actually start creating notes. So when you go to something like OneNote, this is the example that I'm going to show you. These are notebooks. As you can see here, I have 2 notebooks here, RBI preparation and LLB. So when I open RBI prep, I have created some demo notes for you in order to show you how to create notes. So I've created 2 sections here. These are called sections, as you can see here. At the right, at the left bottom, you can see add section. So you can add different sections. For example, I add management here. Okay, so these are different sections that you can add, and you can restructure them as well. Okay, so these are sections in which you will have notes. Now, you can create multiple notes here, which are called pages in OneNote. You can call them notes for your ease of understanding. I call them notes. For example, in Finance Theory Static, the first note that I've created is important terms, as you can see here. Okay, so this is the first note that I've created for your understanding. Now, let me give you an example on how we normally create notes and how we can create better notes. So normally what we do is we number, different topics like this, and then we create subheadings or, subtypes or subtypes, and this is how we create notes. For example, If I want to create a subtype of provident fund, let's say PPF, EPF, let's say SPF, for example, this is a subtype that I've created, okay? So these are the normal ways that we follow in creating notes. There's nothing wrong with them, it's completely okay. And you can use these ways of creating notes. On the other hand, there is a better method that you can follow. For example, I'm creating a note on important terms, okay? Now this is called as Cornell method, and I have made some changes in the Cornell method itself to make note making for competitive examinations even more effective. What exactly can you do? So these are the examples. For example, what I've done is, let me show you how exactly I have done it. So I'm inserting a table of two columns and, for example, six rows. So this is a table that I've inserted. I'm expanding it now. The left column stays the same. The right column is expanded further because the right column is the one where you write majority of your things. Okay. Now, according to the Cornell method, you divide a page into three parts. Okay. Then there are two columns. The left column is where you write headings or where you write points so that you can revise faster. The right column is where you write in detail whatever you're reading. And then there is a column at the, there is a row at the bottom where you, summarize the entire document. We are going to skip that row altogether. So what we've done is we've divided our page. Let's assume that this is one page that we have of our notebook. And on this page, we have divided it into two different parts, the left column and the right column. The left column is a summarization in points of whatever explanation we are giving on the right hand column. Okay. So for example, what are blue chip companies? This is a topic that I've picked up from these notes that I've made. So I believe if we go and look for blue chips, so here it is. Point number 10, what are blue chip companies? So I've written here, safe, quality and reliable. This is something that I've added later. Companies which are considered safe, have a national reputation of quality and reliability, are blue chip companies. Then there are sub questions or further questions on the same topic. Can mid cap companies be blue chips? Why are blue chips called blue chips? So these are the three main questions on blue chips. Then there is book building. So coming to the blue chip again, how have I recreated the same topic here? So the first column here on the right hand side is for asking the question, what are blue chip companies? Or you can put in a statement also. Okay. Then there are statements or explanations of the same question that is being asked. On the left hand side, you summarize it. Safe, quality, reliable. These are the three terms which summarize blue chip companies. Companies which are considered safe have a national reputation of quality and reliability. The next question is, why are blue chips called blue chips? In poker, blue chips were considered the most valuable, coined in 1923 by a trader. In order to remember it, I just write poker chips. Now I can remember why exactly blue chips are called blue chips. I don't need to remember this entire statement also. Okay. There's another question which I've picked up to explain it better. Let me just increase the size of this. Okay. What is efficient market hypothesis? Let me just increase the size of this as well. Okay. The first point here is on the left hand side. All information is already incorporated in share price. This is what summarizes efficient market hypothesis. If I don't remember, I can read the detailed statement here. As per efficient market hypothesis, in a stock market, all information that can affect the share price is already incorporated in the share price. This means that both fundamental and technical analysis are useless. And this is summarized here. All info is already incorporated in share price. There are different forms of efficient markets: weak, semi-strong, and strong. Weak, technical analysis is useless. Fundamental analysis is useful. So I've summarized here. In weak, technical analysis is useless. And it automatically means that fundamental analysis is not useless because I've not mentioned it here. In semi-strong, only private information can help. In strong, both technical analysis and fundamental analysis are useless. So this I can use to revise whatever I have read regularly. Now, how do I revise? For example, this is the note that I've made today, okay, in my studies. And at night before sleeping, I want to revise. What will I do? I will hide this right column and I will make visible only the left column for myself. Can I do that? If I can move it, yes. So I'm moving it to the right. And now you can see I have hidden majority of the right hand side. Only the left hand side is visible. I can move it back after I'm done with the revision. Such beautiful ability to revise. Now, what was the question? What are blue chip companies? Now I can see only this, safe, quality, reliable. So I ask myself, do I remember what are blue chip companies? Blue chip companies are companies that are safe, that are considered of a national high quality and for their reliability, known for their reliability. Poker chips, what was I talking about? Why are blue chips called blue chips? Because it was a term which was coined from poker chips in 1923. What is efficient market hypothesis? According to EMH, all information is already incorporated in the share price. So technical analysis and fundamental analysis in order to identify the share price is useless. So this is how I'm doing revision every night, and this is called as active revision technique. Okay. Now, after I'm done with the revision, I can move it back to the left hand side and we are done. This is how easy it is. Okay. Let me give you another example on how you can make notes. One second. Yes. Let me give you another example on how we can make notes from Spotlight. So Spotlight I have opened here of February, if I'm not wrong. And let's take any topic. Okay. The third topic here says City Innovation Index platform has been launched by Ministry of Housing and Urban Affairs to connect the cities with innovators so that innovation can be fostered in urban areas. And then there is some information about City Innovation Exchange, which was launched recently. So what is the question that I've created in my notes? What is City Innovation Exchange? What is the short form or the short term to remember it? To connect innovators with city administration. Launched by Ministry of Housing and Urban Affairs, in explanation, innovators can find, the objective is innovators will find solutions to the pressing needs of cities. Built on the concept of open innovation, that was proper flow of ideas from inside out, that is from innovators to the administration and from the administration to the innovators. Okay. What is the core objective? To connect innovators in the city with the city administration. Then there was another topic, Asia Economic Dialogue. Let's go through the topic itself. The fourth topic. Fifth edition of Asia Economic Dialogue was jointly organized by Pune International Center and Indian Ministry of External Affairs virtually. The theme was post-COVID-19 global trade and finance dynamics. So because it was an economic dialogue, so the focus was on global trade, number one, and on finance. Okay. This is all we need to remember. So how have I made notes on it? Asia Economic Dialogue, no question here. What is the short term that I need to remember in order to recall everything related to 5th edition of Asia Economic Dialogue? Global trade and finance, that's the core focus of Asia Economic Dialogue. It was organized by two institutions, Pune International Center, Indian Ministry of External Affairs. The theme was post-COVID-19, global trade and finance dynamics, and it was the 5th edition. So this way, I'm going to make notes for the entire Spotlight. Believe me, it's not a very hectic activity. If you cover about 40, 45 pages every day, that's enough. That's the most that you can do, and that should be your target. And at the end of the day, before you close your books or after you've closed your books, you eat your dinner and then you come back to these notes, you take it to the right hand side, you see all these points that you've created and you try to recall what exactly did you read, okay? Believe me, if you do this exercise daily, you will see that even one reading or a maximum of two readings are enough for you to remember everything that you read. That is all you need. If you're doing revision regularly, every day and every week, you're making proper notes with minimum time span, and you're revising them regularly, then you would not need any kind of hand-holding from anyone in your life. And you can clear your examination in a jiffy. So this was all about how to make effective notes. I'll see you very, very soon with more such sessions on how to prepare better for your examination. If you really like this video, do not forget to subscribe to my channel and press that bell icon to get regular notifications whenever I come live. All the best, guys.